Central Bank Trap. I've got a copy of it right here. Daniel, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Let me ask first about your take on the Juncker-Trump meeting. It looks like they're moving closer to true free trade. Do you believe any of these governments in China, in the EU, in Washington really want no tariff, no subsidies, free trade?
No. I mean, most governments want to keep subsidies, tariffs, in order to keep control. They're more interested in control rather than growth, and definitely rather than trade. So that is one of the problems of starting a trade war, because you believe that you're going to lead somebody to take action and be more open, but if they want to exert control in the market, then it's much more complicated. But I believe that right now, for the European Union and for China, there's no other option but to reduce barriers to trade, not just tariff barriers to trade, but also the invisible barriers to trade.
Which are bigger, right?
Exactly, yeah. Which are bigger, like bureaucracy, like all the different subsidies that exist for national champions and domestic segments. So I think that they need to do it, because the European Union cannot reduce its overcapacity, cannot grow as expected 2.2% without a massive trade surplus, and its biggest customer is the US, and the same with China. China would have a tremendous difficulty in absorbing its overcapacity and its internal imbalances if it were not for its ability to trade with the United States. So basically you have on one side the customer that is demanding, and on the other side you have the suppliers.
So let's talk about, first off, the macro picture.
Yeah.
It looks like, listen, when President...
Everyone involved, it is a much bigger benefit for the European Union, it is a much bigger benefit for the United States, obviously, and for China, if we stop this race for more tariffs. So we are moving in that direction of less tariffs and less subsidies, and that is a good thing.
Let's talk specifically about Spain for a moment, because I know you're from Spain, you worked at Citadel, you worked at PIMCO, you're working here in the city, but you advise also the PP on policy, and Spain has had a really tough time bouncing back from the deep recession of the financial crisis. Is this going to be a benefit for Spain? Because the IMF came out last week or earlier this week and said that the euro is overvalued for Spain and holding it back from trade gains.
I disagree with that idea of the IMF, particularly because it's based on a view of purchase parity that is clouded by central bank policy. Now, the euro has been on almost a long-term slide for a very prolonged period of time, and it doesn't benefit consumers, it doesn't benefit savers, it doesn't benefit workers. So I'm not worried about that, because Spain has been able to multiply its exports. At the beginning of the 2011 period, no one believed that Spain could export 33% of GDP, and it is doing so. So there's no problem with the euro in terms of achieving a good growth there. Spain is not a country that has any type of problems with its main trade partners in terms of barriers or tariffs at all, and it's a country that has actually done the reforms. It's done the homework. It's improved its imbalances. It's reduced the deficit by more than 70%, and it needs to continue to do so because the recovery is fragile. The unemployment numbers are coming down rapidly, but the threats of going back to the mistakes of the past are much more.
What needs to be done then? Because okay, you've got strong export growth in Spain, you have strong GDP growth in Spain, but there are still big issues like unemployment that plague the nation. What has to be done to set things right in that economy?
I think that Spain, like so many European countries, have a problem of a perception of protection that doesn't protect anybody, and therefore the very large unemployment levels that we see in some of the southern European economies. So one of the things that needs to be done is to develop the already very successful labor reform to facilitate hiring, which is one of the big problems. And the labor costs in Spain are very, very high still. We need also to reduce taxes to job creators and to families, because it is very difficult to improve consumption, improve growth and domestic demand with such a big tax wedge. The tax wedge for companies and for families in Spain is still very high. So there's a lot that needs to be done, and we should not forget that the country just came from a very, very big crisis.
All right, Daniel, thanks so much for joining us. Really appreciate your time this morning. Daniel Okaya is the chief economist at Tresis. He's also the author of Escape from the Central Bank Trap. And if you want to hear more from Daniel, I'm going to have him on our radio program in just about an hour's time. So tune into Bloomberg Radio Daybreak Europe around 9:30 to hear more from Daniel Okaya.